We're doing a test.
Hello and welcome to church this morning. It's good to see everyone here. It's good to hear voices actively talking with one another and communicating. We also want to say thank you and welcome to the people who are joining us online today. If you haven't had the chance to meet me, or I haven't had the pleasure to meet you, I should say, my name is Tom. I get to be one of the pastors here at RCC. And so if you're new or if you're visiting us, we'd like to extend an extra special welcome as well. We do have a couple of special guests joining us this week, which is great. So this week, it is my privilege or my pleasure to be leading the service or hosting for what will be about roughly the next hour of what we'll be doing here today. And we're going to actually be finishing today our values series. I'm not sure if you've enjoyed it. I've enjoyed it. I've learned a lot about different perspectives on what our values mean. And so if you haven't been around for them, here are the values that we've been going over. Authenticity, connection, and storytelling, which we heard from Kay last week. And I wonder how you went this week sharing your story and creating seeds for sharing your faith through conversation. Today's value is moving forward, and we get to hear from our very own Cam Porteous delivering the message, which I believe it might be Cam's first time jumping up for a message. So when that time comes, please make sure he feels welcome. I have a sneak peek of the slides, and I'm excited to hear the message as well. I think we'll all enjoy it and relate to it. But before we get there, we're going to have a moment or a chance to respond to God's love for us this week in worship and music. So as the band comes up and comes on stage to lead us, I just ask that you reflect on your past week and choose to move from those good moments that you've seen God And reflect on where you've seen God this week and lean into that as you worship today.
I just want to thank Boy Boy again for playing for us. And I think it's important to point out that some of these songs he's never sung before, so he's learning them from scratch. So if it comes together, it will be wonderful, but we need your help. You know these songs really well. So let's stand up and we're going to sing together The Stand. This song is about offering our heart to God. So let's just do that this morning as we sing.
Thank you.
That's a great start. Beautiful singing. Our next song is Great Are You, Lord. And this song's about restoration and God sustaining us. So let's really sing this one. Give praise back to God.
We're going to head into our kids' spot and invite our kids to come up the front while we have a quick chat, and then they'll be heading on out the back. So if I could have some kids come up the front, that would be good. It's all right. If you're shy, you don't absolutely have to, but it would be nice. We've got some volunteers. It's good. What about my kids, Charlie, Riley? Typical, not listening to Dad, that's right. While we wait for anyone else that might be coming, we're talking about fruit today. Does anyone like fruit? I like fruit. What about the crowd? Anyone? Cool, yeah, good. All right. What is your favorite fruit? Charlie, what's your favorite fruit? Pineapple. That, I didn't expect that. All right. Who else? Anyone got a favorite? Strawberry for Timmy. Apple. Nice. Cherries. They're all good. They're all pretty good options. Banana, Finn, nice. Love it. So there's something pretty interesting about fruit because we probably often just buy them from the shops, right? Is that where you find your fruit? Yeah. Well, fruit grow on trees and all that sort of stuff. So they don't actually just appear in our shop magically. People actually have to go and get them and then bring them to us. Let me see what I've got here. So we've got a picture up on the screen of someone grabbing fruit. That's kind of what it looks like. But there's lots and lots of people who do it for us. And then we get to have it on our table. And it appears there. And then we finally get to enjoy the fruit. And the interesting thing is, over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about different fruits of the Spirit. We've been talking about kindness and love and peace. And today we'll talk about joy in Kids Church. And so the interesting thing is we actually need to go out and try and grab those sort of fruit. We don't just get them magically. So it's a lot of effort sometimes. So the best way we can ask for, the best way to go out and get the fruit of the Spirit or to put it in effort is to ask God for help. So do you want to have a quick prayer asking God to help us have joy and peace and love and kindness, and then we'll go out the back? Sound good? Awesome. All right. Dear God, thank you so much that you love us and that you give us these fruits of the Spirit that help us love you and love others well. We ask that you help us be mindful of what we do and what we say so that we can show these different fruits to all those around us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, cool. Well, we're going to ask you to go out the back with some of your leaders and do some more stuff to do with fruit. Sound good? All right. And while they go out the back, we're going to have announcements. I know, super exciting. So, like I mentioned earlier, this is our value series that we're ending with this week. So, again, if you didn't get to hear any of it, jump online, listen on YouTube. We have it there. But today we have Cam talking to us about moving forward. Again, I can't overstate it. I am quite excited. Next, we're coming up to Easter. Easter's actually not far away at all. It's another 5 Sundays, if you don't include this Sunday, until Easter. And so we're going into an Easter series called The Road to Easter, and we're going to look at different elements at different times of the week. So I encourage you to come along for that. We've got some pretty good speakers with Glenn Tweedy and Andy Hodgson, who some of you might know, coming along and joining us to share a message. So I do encourage you for that. And next week is me talking about anticipating the promise. Mainly music is on, and I encourage you, if you have young children and don't go, to talk to one of the Mainly Music team today if you can, and find out more about it. It is really good both for spiritual type reasons and in learning about God's love for your kids and yourself, but also actually helps with socialization and development and all those sorts of things too. There's a whole bunch of reasons to go. As always, we invite you to join us for morning tea and to have a chat with us after the service. We don't want you to just sit here and listen to a message on a Sunday. We also want to get to know you and listen to what's going on in your life and to share our life with you as well. Mission Awareness Program is Sunday, February 25th, which is today, if I'm not mistaken. And it's at 4 to 5:30. Where is it? It's in Ballarat, which I thought. Peel Street Gospel Chapel. I have been to a couple of these. They're really good to find out more about what's going on in the wider mission of the church and to be able to pray for these people who are doing some hard work in some hard places. Up and Overs, Tuesday 27th. So that's, again, this Tuesday, 11:30 here in the building. So come enjoy some morning tea, coffee, and above all, sharing some time together. The AGM is coming up. So if you're a member or if you're not a member, there's some important things to be aware of. So it's on April 21st, as mentioned. We ask that you start praying and thinking about who you might want to nominate to be a part of our leadership structure, so elders and board members. We also have membership forms available. So if you're not actually an official member of the incorporation, which is more the legal side of it, we encourage you to join. It means that you can help make decisions about the future direction of the church, and it means your voice gets to be heard in a really official way, and we can actually do a whole lot with that. Any questions around it, we do ask you to talk to Phil Adams, who isn't here today, or Greg Mello, or you can also just talk to one of the other elders and board members, and if we don't know the answer, we'll direct you to Greg or Phil. There's Connect cards available as well. This is another way you can let us know what's going on in your life. And if it's your first time or you only come here a couple of times, it's also a way for us to be able to talk to you more throughout the week with our newsletter and things like that. Now, if there's a prayer request or a praise request, we ask that you jot that down, but mark whether it's private so that we only share it with our core prayer team, or if it's public and our whole church can be praying with you or celebrating with you. If you don't like pen and paper, we do have an email, admin@ringwoodcommunitychurch.com, that we encourage you to send to, but please, again, just note down whether it's public or private. For most things, other than that, you can jump on our website. At the moment, this address is not doing well, so we ask that you just change the .co to .au, and it'll work out fine for you. And if you missed out on any services, again, if you go to myrcc.au this week and then look for services there, you'll be able to look at any past services or this one in a couple of hours. Alrighty, that is all those announcements, but there's also another announcement that's pretty important. For those of you who might not know, there are two people getting married next week in our church, Shross and Katie. And so as people get married, we as a church would love to celebrate with them and to pray with them to help prepare for what is often one of the most stressful weeks ever. So if we could invite Sarosh and Katie up to join us, that would be great. I can hear an appropriate kids song happening at church, Joy Down in My Heart. So, for those of you who don't know, this is Katie and Sarosh. Sarosh has been at RCC for quite some time. Katie, more a new development, but both of them have been very significant in the life of RCC, both jumping in to a whole wide range of different ministry opportunities and leadership type roles, and really critical stuff. So they're very important to us. They're also good friends. So it's good to have you guys be married next week, and we look forward to celebrating with you. But before you guys were even around here, you were with some other people who are pretty special who we have today, which are your parents. My understanding is that they both your families raised you in the faith, in a faith journey. And so that's important, and we want to celebrate that too see that the rich rewards and blessings of that. And we get to reap that a lot at RCC. So we want to thank the family as well. If we could give a clap to the family, that would be great. Now, we do have a gift for you as well as you guys get married. It's just a small gift of a devotional. It's a pretty good one. So I encourage you to go through it over the first year of marriage. I'm sure as you both connect with each other and God, that it would be a rich journey. Now, we would like to pray, like I mentioned, and I would like to invite some people up who are willing to come up to say some words over Katie and Sarosh, and then I'll finish off if that's all right. So if we could all stand together, whether you're coming up or not, and if some people could come up. Thanks, Cam. Good, good, good. Thanks, Ian. All righty. Cam, do you want to start for us?
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what we can have Sarosh and Katie and the family here today to be able to celebrate the couple, to celebrate the marriage that is to come. Lord, we pray that you are forever intertwined with Sarosh and Katie, that the three go together and stay strong and united in marriage. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, we just thank you for these guys. We thank you for the contribution they make to our church and the active part they are with us. We just thank you for that. We ask for your blessing on their coming wedding and marriage together, and we just want to commit them to you, Lord. We ask that you just pour out your favour on them in this time. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Dear Lord, thanks so much for the blessing that is Katie and Sarosh individually, but also the blessing that they are together. We ask that as they continue to journey closer to you and to each other, that you'd be there every step of the way, guiding them to bring you more glory and bringing them a richer and fuller life than they could possibly have otherwise. We're so grateful for their journey in faith that starts with first their parents, but on to them. And we just thank you that we also as a community get to reap the rewards of a faithful journey that has started many, many years ago. We ask that as a community you help us surround Katie and Sarosh in faith and in encouragement and support as they embark on this next chapter of their journey together. We also ask that you strengthen them together. Like a three-string chord, it is stronger when you are present. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks so much, guys. You can sit on down. Now, we are also going to enter into a time of community prayer. So, if it hasn't been obvious, we believe in prayer as a powerful way to communicate to God, but also as a way that God communicates back into our heart, transforming it to be closer to His. So, if you would join me in prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we give thanks for the beautiful creation that you have made. We glorify you in your ways, which are higher than our own. We thank you that you have decided to continue faithfully in relationship with us. That you meet us wherever we are. You meet us on the go and make yourself known to us. But that your journey with us doesn't stop there. That you keep moving forward with us, transforming us as we go into a new and beautiful creation. We give thanks because you have set us free. Free from many things, but today, Lord, we particularly thank you for the freedom to be who we are in you. We declare your goodness. You are the only one who is good. Even when life feels outside of our control, we know it is in your good hands. Father, we lift up our world today with so many people dealing with tragic and violent disasters, with war and desperate actions resulting in loss and confusion. We particularly lift up the many areas of our world currently dealing with conflict. That your peace would be with them as they move forward. That the leadership would be guided by you in all your wisdom so that every community may move forward into a new era of peace. We also lift up those ministries that are outside of Australia, those missionaries who do great work in spreading your love to those far places. We ask that you be with them, strengthening them, and giving them courage and boldness in those times when they might feel very afraid and very frail. Jesus, we lift up our nation also, that as many people experience anxiousness and fear over our current realities, that as many people look to the future and don't see a clear way forward, we ask that you would be by their side supporting them. We ask that your warm love be felt by those who are suffering, whether it is medically, socially, or financially. We ask that you bring us together as a nation, that we may be known as a loving nation that looks after one another, just as you have asked us to do. Lord, we also lift up our state and our local community. We pray for peace and protection right now, particularly for those who are vulnerable. We ask that you provide ways for them to access whatever they need, both physically and mentally. We ask you to show us ways that we can do our part in that journey and be with them and supporting them in real, practical ways. Spirit, may you encourage us and remind us to keep in contact with those who are socially isolating so that they know that they are not alone, even if they sometimes feel like they are. We pray for our leaders with difficulties that never seem to end, that you'd be with them, renewing them and guiding them. Jesus, we lift up our own ministries as well, as they've started well into the year, that you would be with them and guiding them, that you'd draw new people into them so that we may share you with them. We may share your love. We pray for our own weeks ahead, that you may strengthen us and renew us also, that we may be positive influences in our own communities this week, in our own circles, that we may always be wise and loving so that we can point all people that we interact with to you, so that we may be good ambassadors for you, and may the Holy Spirit work through us this week. Lastly, we pray for the message that we are about to hear, that it may transform our lives to be closer to you and your love and purpose for us, that you'd be with Cam as he shares, that your voice would be heard clearly through what Cam is sharing with us today, and that it would not just sit here on a Sunday, but it would transform the rest of our weeks. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to invite Ian to come up to give us our Bible reading, and then Cam will be up after that.
Reading from Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. Thanks, Cam.
Moving in. Well, thank you, and good morning, everyone. My name is Cam, and as Tom did announce at the start, this is my first time coming up and sharing a sermon, so we'll see how graceful everyone here is. I'm hoping we go well. But let's just open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can be here today. We pray and thanks that so many can be here in this building and for those who are online. We pray that today's message that I share, that you share through me, Lord, is able to reach people in a personal way and an intentional way, something that they take something out of today, that gets drawn closer to you, Lord, closer to Jesus. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so for the month of February, we've been focusing on a four-part series on values for 2024 that we want to intentionally focus on for Ring Community Church, not exclusively, just intentionally. We've had authenticity, connection, storytelling, and I'm closing the loop on moving forward. And I think that second line is a good way to put it, living in constant journey with God. So firstly, I'd like to share a bit about myself. Some of you may know me at different names or know a little bit about me, so I'll clear the air on that. My name's Cam. I'm a husband, a father in our family of four. I'm also a son and a brother in our family of five. And it's great today that I have my wife, Dale, my son's Finn. I'm so glad he's in there. That's great. Oscar and my dad Gavin here today to be present. I live in a community, so I'm a neighbour. I attend here at Ringwood Community Church, and I have many connections with friends. I'm a sport lover. Oh man, I like to run. But I particularly follow the ABC of sport. We're talking AFL, basketball and cricket, come on. I've previously played each at a local level to the best of my ability, and then my body just fell short. So here I am, passionately following it. I've completed studies in civil engineering and management, and have worked as an engineer for the state government on major projects for the last 8 years. I also wanted to talk about my journey with God, a little bit about this storytelling that we heard about last week. So what's my story? Well, I grew up in a Christian household, and we attended a Catholic church, and we were enrolled at a Catholic school. I primarily learnt who God is during church and at school classes. As a teenager, I felt something missing within me, something big, something important. And this led me to go in my own direction, trying different things to fill this void in my heart. And I gave less time to church. You know, in our household right now, my son keeps on telling me that he can do so many things by myself. This was something I very much did by myself. At uni, I met Dale. We became friends, and after some time, she invited me to come and see a new church she started going to, right here at Ringwood Community Church. At first, I said no way. But eventually, after more invitations, I decided to come and see. Ringwood Community Church was a new experience of Christianity for me, where it just wasn't the priest or the pastor that could pray. Anyone could. It blew my mind. And I could see the relationships the people and the pastor had with God. It was something more than I had experienced before. I could see the relationships that the people and the pastor had with God, and I was curious. It wasn't something that was just followed like reading a book from start to finish, but it was a lifestyle. This new feeling of love. The people here at RCC were also really friendly and warm to me from all different generations. And I thought maybe this could be that answer to that big something that I was missing in my life. So I decided to come back. And I joined a young adults group, and I came to learn more. Years later, I found my eyes open to the teaching. My heart softened to realize that Jesus was the big thing in my life I was seeking, and decided to accept Jesus in my heart as Savior, start my new relationship with God, and to be baptized. So how does this about me all tie to today's service? Well, today's Bible reading is from the book of Matthew. It's also referred to as the Great Commission. Jesus returns to his disciples in Galilee after dying on the cross, taking the sins of the world, and then rising from the dead and ascending to heaven. Jesus came to his disciples and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey in everything I've commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of age." Now, these verses of the Bible apply to Jesus' disciples, but they also apply to all that have accepted Jesus in their hearts as Savior too. So how does Jesus want us to go in our life and fulfill this commit? How do we go at living this disciple-maker lifestyle? Let's unpack this further. So when we meet Jesus in our life, he invites us to come and follow him. When we learn for ourselves that Jesus is our Savior, a transformation happens to us. You know, Paul mentions to us in Romans chapter 6 that our old selves are crucified and we are alive to a new life. It's in this new life that Jesus mentions that we are the salt and light to the world, and that our relationship with God has an impact on those who come in contact with it. Jesus shows us in the book of John, chapter 15, when convicting the parable of the grapevine, that, in fact, we did not choose Jesus, but Jesus chose us and appoints us to go and produce good fruit, everlasting fruit
to spread the good news. If we reflect on this and then go back to the command in the Great Commission to therefore go and make disciples of all nations, what does this mean? If we look at the word go is a doing word, and it's a funny one where it can be both a verb and a noun. So the verb is referring to travel. The noun is referring to attempting something. In this context here, it's a verb. It's to travel. Some may think when they hear go and... to go and make disciples of all nations, that we need to travel overseas, to a remote village, where maybe English isn't spoken, and that's where I need to be. That's where I need to take Jesus. You know what I say to this? That may be the case. Maybe, if that is what God has asked. But that doesn't apply to everyone. What does apply to everyone is this. When I read the word go, I think it's helpful to add on the start, a silent as you. As you go. Jesus wants us to bring Jesus to all types of people as we go in our life. I know if I think back to my connections that I was mentioning earlier, there's a lot of people in that mix. So who are the people in my life that need Jesus? I want to show a tool. Some of us may have seen before at a My Friends training session, and it's been also done at a sermon here some years ago, and it's called a daisy chain. Now, a daisy chain, if I mention this at work, they're going to think it's something completely different where you have a chain around a secured gate and it's got two locks or more locks so you're able to open it and lots of people can get into a secured area. Not the same daisy chain. I was thinking of this one when they mentioned it at work. It was not great. But anyway. So this one is a tool that can be used for bringing Jesus to help people through multiplication. And that's really important. So here's how it works. You write your name in the middle. So I've put my example up here. That's me. And each petal represents a social group. Where are you in life as you go? So I've put family, I've put friends, I go drop Finn off at childcare, I've got neighbours, I go to a cafe, I go to work at two places, at an office and at site. So I was happy to split them up. Next after that is start to list people in those petals. You know who you think need Jesus. I ran out of space, so I thought it was a bit hard to put it on my daisy chain here on the screen. But this one can be tricky because how do we know if people need Jesus or not? Only God knows that. Only the individual knows that. So I'd suggest do a conservative approach here and put down people you know. You can use this daisy to pray for different people in your world. You can also pray to God to reveal who He wants you to have intentional relationship with. When we look at Jesus, whilst He had a high amount of followers, He only invested intentional relationships in the few, encouraging him to be disciple makers. And this was intentional by Jesus as He plants the seed of multiplication. We'll go through this in a scenario. Take this first daisy as my daisy, and I'm living an intentional relationship with someone from my world. Let's say the barista at my local cafe. That represents the grey petal. This person comes to meeting Jesus, and they too have their own daisy, which has their own social groups and connections. The barista is encouraged to bring Jesus to people, just like I, and they go and start talking to the cafe owner, the next grey petal. And the owner comes to meet Jesus. The owner finds Jesus and has their own daisy and is encouraged to bring Jesus to people. And they go and start to have intentional relationship with the friend at the gym. And you can see what happens here. Each person has their own social connection groups. And if they've got the intention as a disciple maker, they are able to spread Jesus the good news through multiplication. I only invested into one, and you can see how much the investing in one done properly, this is just a scenario, can have that multiplication factor. Now, something that I have got is a daisy chain, and I've printed off a template. This is from my friends. I'm going to have them both at the front and at the back for you to take home and for you to be able to fill out for yourself a good task to do, even if it's just for praying. Now, I mentioned earlier, Jesus wants us to bring Jesus to all different types of people as we go in life. The scenario we went through was an example that could occur in one moment in life. Now, that's a really exciting moment. We love when that happens and when we see it and we celebrate it, absolutely. But that doesn't happen all the time. So what about all the other moments in life? How do we sustain ourselves so that we're ready when the opportunity arises? So at the start of the sermon, you may recall, I said I like to run. Previously, I've been challenged to do a half marathon, a few of them actually. So for those who don't know the length of that, that's about 21.1 kilometres. Okay, once you've done yours in April, you'll be able to do this for sure. I was excited about the challenge ahead, but I was strongly warned from experienced runners, don't just turn up race day and give it a go. You'll fail. You'll fall short. You need to do a lot of training and preparation so that come race day, your body is in tip-top shape to perform. When I see how we are when I see how Jesus wants us to be disciple makers, the same warning absolutely applies. So you see, I've got a bag with me. I thought I'd mix it up a little bit and get some curiosity. What's in the bag? What's he doing? Is he moving in? Is he being kicked out? No, I'm here. I'm able to go home. It's great. We're good. Now, today I've brought some props. I thought of mixing it up, and I thought I'd share something that's important healthy habits that I've learned in my preparation from my training for the big runs, which I think can represent healthy habits for being a disciple maker. So these represent studying the Word. As a runner, if I'm feeding myself with good food, including portion size, lots of water, and a good amount of sleep, my body is at the right nutrition and performs at its optimum conditions. Conversely, when I eat and drink poorly, don't get enough sleep, and try and go for a run, my body screams at me in pain, and I have a poor outcome. Happens a lot. As a disciple maker, when we're studying the Word, we surround ourselves with Jesus and His teachings and remain connected to Him. And when we don't put in the time to study the Word, we're not surrounding ourselves with Jesus and His teachings and have the risk of falling, of forgetting what He taught us and falling into old habits living in this broken world. As humans, we do have short-term memory issues. In the book of John, chapter 15, Jesus tells us a story, a parable about a grapevine. Verse 5, Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I remain in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. So a reflection item here is regarding our environment, your environment. What are you feeding yourself? Your eyes? Your ears? Your thoughts? Are you getting enough rest? How is your soul? Okay, time for second reveal. Ooh, a bit smelly. Some runners. Now, I wanted to say good runners, but you can see the condition. They were good once upon a time. So these are some sturdy runners. And this represents being prepared for the long journey ahead. You know, preparing for a big run like a half marathon, the training required to complete, they say, is to build the condition into your legs and into your body. You start really small distance, say like 3 kilometer runs, 3 to 5 times a week. And in between all those days, you're supposed to be resting and getting some gym work in, strength and conditioning, and progressively building the kilometers, building the strength until, and this takes for months and months, so that come race day, your body is conditioned to run the distance. And so a good number that people try and aim for before a 21.1 kilometer run is to be able to do 18 kilometers. That's a good starting point. And at a good pace too. So then when come race day, you bring that momentum and everything with you, you give it your all, and you can put in a good outcome. Now, if you think about all those kilometers in that training that you need to be able to do, you can see there's significantly more kilometers that I need to run, that we all need to run in the training than the actual run itself. And that the performance of your runners, they're key equipment to have a successful outcome. When reflecting on this as a disciple maker, this talks to items that Phil spoke about in week one's sermon of authenticity, being an authentic Christian. We are called to live a Christ-like lifestyle daily and build intentional relationships. In the book of Philippians, Paul teaches in chapter 2, verse 5, that we must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Now, God is the one who's in the business of transforming hearts. That's his job. And he wants us to help people have the opportunity to come and see, to learn who God is. Important thing to note here is while God calls us to assist, he's the one who changes people's hearts towards him. So, if that's the case, what does God want us to do then? He wants us to walk like Jesus walked. In the first book of Corinthians, Paul says this, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but it was God who made the seed grow. And it's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. What's important is that God made the seed grow. The one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose. And both will be rewarded for their own hard work. So what does this mean for us? We could be the planter who plants the seed. They may be an important piece in someone's journey, but they're there for a small period of time and they go. We may be the worker who waters the seed, the one who's putting in the countless hours, the one who spends a long time journeying with someone. Now, if I reflect on my own journey, I can see at least 5 key individuals that I can think of that influenced myself in my relationship with God. Some were the ones who watered me, where I learnt, who studied, and shared in the teachings of the Bible intentionally. Some were the ones who planted that seed. I didn't know that they were Christians until afterwards, but I could just tell, after just seeing how they carried themselves, that they were different. And I suspected that they might have been Christians. It was true. So the reflection item here is to think, who were the key people who helped you find Jesus? Did they plant the seed? Did they water? Okay, third item in my bag. This one needs a lot of imagination. If you can't see this, this is a knee strap. Oof, Cam, welcome to your 30s. That's right. Now, for me, this represents faith and trust in God. This might be a stretch. Please stick with me. It'll come. Okay. During my training, as I started to increase the distance in my running, I had hurdles. Hurdles that felt like I just wanted to give up. There was one which I can reflect on, being sick with a lung infection during the training. It really impacted my ability, and the precious time that I had to train. You could hear before how much you had to put in. My biggest hurdle I have faced in running was something called runner's knee. Now that sounds really good for a runner, to have runner's knee. Not the case. It's bad. Runner's knee is a condition I have where I'm fine when I walk, but after about 1 kilometre of running, it feels like the bones of my knees are rubbing and it gets to a pain. And the pain quickly grows to an unbearable level and forces me to stop. So that happens for me, as I said, for a really short distance of time. So I seek medical professional help during my training to help improve my condition. This included costly osteo sessions, I'm saying like multiple times a week, painful rehab and strengthening, along with long doses of rest to let the body heal and get stronger. And that resulted in me still having runner's knee the next time I try to run and get that debilitating pain again. At this point, I was getting really upset. I was only a few weeks out from my run and was not happy. I ended up doing that first run in a poor state. Second time round, it happened again years later. And I was just really upset. What's going on? I won't be able to achieve my goal. And past this, I'm going to be limited in life to not be able to run more than 1 kilometre without being in pain. Then I found this. This is a knee strap which costs $15 on Amazon, plus delivery, which says it's supposed to help with runner's knee. And I thought, are you kidding me? Like, after all this time I've spent on money, on physio, on osteo, on rehab, the pain, that's not going to solve anything. It's just a bit of strap. Anyway, I bought it, waited for the delivery, and when it arrived, I gave it a go. Amazingly, the pain was manageable, and I was starting to run some longer distance. That night, I bought a second pair. It was great. And since then, I've been able to, with my knee strap, be able to get to a state where I don't have knee pain at all when running long distances. Now, that's a long story. But for a disciple maker, we will also have hurdles in our life, which makes us feel like we just want to give up. We might be in a bad place. We might be in pain. We may be tempted by the devil to do things evil that we may have done in our old life. What do we do in these moments? How do we get past these hurdles? It's pretty simple, this one. It's we are to take it and to give it all to God. Now, in the book of James, chapter 4, we read James say this: humble yourself before God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts. For your loyalty is divided between God and the world. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter, and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up with honor. Now, that's some powerful words that James uses there, and he obviously very intentional there. But God wants us to give it all to him in prayer, every bit of it. And when we do, we're to listen to the Holy Spirit. Jesus says in the book of John, chapter 16, but when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. But he doesn't speak on his own, but he only tells what he's heard. He will tell you about the future. Now, the Holy Spirit is God's way of being able to speak to us. But we need to be able to be listening to the Holy Spirit. We might be able to pray, give it all to him, but if we're not listening to the Holy Spirit, not trying to hear God back, what are we doing? So the reflection piece here is, where do you put your faith when times get tough? Okay, I'm up to my final one. What's my last item in my bag? Another pair of runners. Even dirtier, even more used. So those sturdy runners represent finding a friend. You may have picked it up earlier, but I've done 3 half marathons. My first attempt, I was doing the training by myself. I found it hard to keep up with the demands of the training and life, and my run come race day represented this. Sure, I finished, but the time was not good. And whilst I was glad to cross the finish line, I was really not happy about how I went. The next time I tried was many years later in 2022. Look, I trained solo during that time, but I had my very fit brother-in-law occasionally send me a text saying, "How are you going with your training?" And that was enough to kick me off the couch and get me on the track. End result was I trained a lot better and finished with a better time. My latest attempt was in 2023, last year. And I had a team at work that was looking to go and do the half marathon. They also said they wanted to train and do it all before work on a Monday morning, go for a run together. Message was sent in a group chat and you could all see who was coming and who wasn't. And we also talked non-stop about running because we all saw each other at work. This training was the best ones I had. And come race day of that last run that I did, smashed my personal best time by a long shot out of the park after what I can confirm, and I think others can confirm who know closely, but that was one of the hardest years of my life outside of the run. I'm very proud of that result, something I won't forget. In my reflection, I know there was a lot of power in my running community, and the same can be said for disciple makers. God designed us to live in community. God wants us to live with people, not just the key milestones, like a wedding, but the in-betweens, the everyday life. This is the way God created us. It's the same in our new life as a Christian. You know, Jesus says in the book of Matthew, chapter 18, "For where 2 or 3 gather together as my followers, I am there among them." When we have a friend, or if we're in a small group, or even both, we invite people into our lives and get the opportunity to share what we are going through, to pray with each other, and to have someone follow up with us, someone to hold us accountable. Jesus said in chapter 5, verse 16, "Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed, and that the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results." So the reflection question here is, do you have someone who is journeying with you? Coincidentally for myself, mine's a running buddy, so that works out well. To summarize it all here, I've put a few things in today, so I thought I'd bring them back on the screen. And close in this. Some people may know that we are renting in our house currently and we're looking to buy. We're spending a lot of our time doing our research online on houses and going to places and we're checking them out. And certain ones look good, can't afford it. Certain ones don't look good, don't want to afford it. Some look in between and we might be considering it. And we put these thoughts of a subject to condition. You know, that one looks really good, but subject to finance maybe, who knows. You know, looks all right from the outside, but I want to do a subject to pest and inspection, please. Oh, yeah. And they might be able to help us out. You know, that is trying to show to the buyer that I'm not fully committed. It's subject to this. If it passes this condition, you know, then I'm on. When we think about our healthy habits to being a disciple maker, to maintaining and preserving ourselves for when the time is right. A reflection point here is, do we have any subject to conditions when it comes to Jesus? If I think about it in the running analogy, I'm ready to do a run, but I'm not ready to eat well. Or I'm not ready to, you know, give up my busy life and sleep. I'm not prepared to go the extra miles. I'll just turn up race day. That'll do. And when it gets tough, I'm out. I'll just do it by myself. I can do it by myself. What's your subject to? Something to think about. Finally, let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you today that we are asked to come on the journey with you and to bring Jesus to those who need him. Thank you, Lord, that you are the one who grows the seed in our hearts and in everyone's hearts. Lord, for the role that you ask us to play as a disciple maker in this multiplication, we just pray, Lord, that you can continue to have healthy habits instilled in us and that we can constantly come to you and friends for support. Pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. I'm trying to think of who's coming up next.
Sometimes I find myself thinking about the humanity of Jesus and how difficult it would have been for him to go to the cross. We talk a lot about anxiety now, but what if you were born knowing that one day you would have to die for the sins of the world? What an incredible thing, and quite difficult to understand, isn't it? But he did. He didn't. Even though he wanted to, he didn't bow out. He still went to the cross and died for us. So we're going to stand now. We're going to sing, "Here I Am to Worship." So if you can just stand with me now.
Here I am to worship, here I am to pray.
We are coming up to that moment where we have communion in church. So if you haven't grabbed any of the elements, they're at the back on the table if you're here in person. If you're online, I guess you can pause and I guess you can see what sort of face I'm making at the moment. So before we get there, though, I want to thank a couple of people especially. So that gives you some time to go grab some stuff too. Firstly, I want to thank Boy Boy for so much of your time and effort this entire month coming up and playing guitar for us. Without Boy Boy, we wouldn't have been able to have live worship this month at all. And so we're really appreciative to him. I would ask that we can all show our appreciation now as well. And thank you to Cam for a great message, a rich message full of some pretty good one-liners and ideas in there. One that I guess want to highlight before we get to another point is 3 kilometres is not a short distance to run, Cam. I cannot run that at all. But I'm glad that it's part of the journey. So, like I said, we're coming up to communion. So one thing that I do like to highlight is as we do communion, we do tend to do it have the different elements together. If you're wanting to join us in that, I do try and make that very clear when we're doing it, so you don't have to worry when that might be. So you can just focus and reflect and connect with God. So for communion today, I was thinking about 2 Corinthians 5:17, where it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old has gone, the new is here." So as we gather around the communion table metaphorically today, I want us to reflect on that profound truth of transformation that is found in Christ. Communion is not just a ritual or a checklist thing that we need to do. It's actually something that we choose as a church to do each week, and it's because it's powerful. And we actually get to encounter that transformative power of God's love each week in it. So just as the bread and wine are transformed into symbols of Christ's body and blood that was broken for us and shed for us, so too are our lives transformed through our unity with Christ. So in partaking of the different elements, we remember Christ's sacrifice on the cross, where he bore our sins and he actually made it possible for us to be reconciled to God. But it's not just in that one moment where we accept Christ's sacrifice for us, but it's a continual journey of moving forward and transformation. It's not just about looking back, but it's about embracing our current reality of a transformed life and moving forward. So through his death and resurrection, we've been made new. The old has passed away and the new has come. So as we partake of the bread, I want us to remember that we are nourished by the bread of life, who is Jesus Christ himself. So if you could have the cracker. And as we sip from the cup or the juice, let us remember the blood shed for us, which cleanses us from all sin and empowers us to live victoriously and transformed lives. Let us also embrace the transformational power of his grace, which gives us the freedom to live as a new creation, as we drink together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of communion. For the gift of communion where we encounter the transforming power of your love. Your love that was nailed to a cross, that was buried and raised again so that we may also come into new life. May you remind us every day of your sacrifice and the new life that we now have. We ask that you transform us, Lord, by your grace, and empower us to live as faithful witnesses of your love. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so there's two points that I kind of wanted to highlight from Cam's message that I really, really loved. Firstly, is the daisy chains is something that's not necessarily new to me, but is something that I've personally found powerful in my prayer life and in my life of trying to connect with people and connect them to God. So I would encourage you to grab any of the templates Cam has. If you can't get your hands on it, you can easily draw it. However, I do encourage you to grab one, because whenever I say I'm just going to draw it at home, I often forget. So grab something tangible. The other thing is that the idea of there is a lot of work that happens in the background before the race. And in fact, that work is more than what happens in the race. And so this idea that that moment where you might have a meaningful conversation with someone or whatever that might look like, that's the moment we're training for, but that's not where all the work is. You need to be doing something before then too. You need to be preparing yourself for it. So I encourage you to find out what that might be. And that might be the daisy chain. It might be studying the word, like Cam was saying, and many of the different examples Cam gave. Choose one of them and focus on that, and that would be great. I'm going to ask the band to come up one last time as we finish up our service and worship together. And then as soon as the band finish, we'll be able to go out and have morning tea.
Our last song this morning is Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. So that's something that we can take with us into this week. Our chains are gone. So let's stand and sing this together.
Once was darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame. Thank you. when circled from every side, when pressured and put to flight, don't stumble or come undone, for we are not swallowed in depths of doubt, when troubled and trampled down, daughter, do not despair, son, he won't leave. His light has shone. In Christ see the glory of God. From darkness his light has shone. In Christ see